So, our featured speaker for tonight is Dr. Nancy Lonsdorf. Dr. Lonsdorf is the former medical director of the Raj, as well as the Maharshi Ayurveda Medical Center in Washington, D.C. She's taught Maharshi Ayurveda to medical doctors at Scripps Institute. She's the author and co-author of The Ageless Woman and A Woman's Best Medicine.
Back to Ayurveda, the source of this knowledge, and thought, well, let's look at what it tells us. So for the next few minutes, I would like to just kind of give a brief overview of what Ayurveda tells us maintains good health. And then I would like to also add what we know in today's medicine and what relevance that might have for our lives and our health and our longevity. So, first of all, Maharshi Ayurveda describes there are three pillars of health. Does anyone remember what those three pillars are? I hear a lot of laughs, but not a lot of answers. Well, we could guess, I guess. I mean, I was just talking to a gentleman, and I was asking him, do you sleep anymore these days? Because I was ready to scold him since I have some statistics for him now. And he said, yeah, I actually try to sleep 7 hours a night now. And I said, well, that's really good. In fact, the research shows that those people who consistently sleep 7 hours, that's the best health as far as sleep goes. Now, if one sleeps as little as 5 hours or less, it doubles the risk of cardiovascular disease. So, and also diabetes and depression and all sorts of things start going downhill when we don't get enough sleep. So sleep is one of the three pillars of health according to Maharshi Ayurveda. And sleep is really nothing to take lightly. Sleep is so valuable. In fact, there's a saying in Ayurveda that sleep is the nurse of all living beings. And indeed, I think you probably have that feeling if you have the chance to go to bed early and that find that you feel like when you wake up in the morning, like your body has been sort of soothed and integrated, and that soma or ojas is lively and everything kind of feels good, calm, smooth inside. And if you don't get enough sleep, that you feel the opposite. Everything feels kind of disjointed. And indeed, that would be an experience of vata imbalance, which is one of the main causes, according to Ayurveda, in a sense of aging or accompanies aging. So sleep, number of hours, and also we know the biorhythm is important. And I wanted to share with you that there's some research recently that scientists are discovering that the cells in the body, that they've discovered that most of the cells, I think they'll eventually find all the types of cells, actually have little timekeepers, little clocks inside them that are ticking away and are registering, you know, what time it is in terms of the circadian rhythm. And they actually have optimal functioning at certain times of the day. And I just bet they might find that at noontime, the digestive cells are actually most active and most efficient in digesting the food. We'll find that, you know, modern medicine is starting to reinvent the wheel, so to speak, and discovering how what Ayurveda has known for 5,000 years plus, you know, that knowledge that's programmed into nature, which is the Veda and which is Ayurveda. So some researchers in this field, chronobiology, one notable one at Johns Hopkins, Dr. Hattar, has done so much research in this area in animals that he's adopted himself a very Ayurvedic lifestyle, although he doesn't know it. He said he now goes to bed very early, and he gets up early, and he turns the lights down at night, and when he travels, he has another strategy for realigning his biological clock quickly. And he said, actually, animals do not think as clearly. They do not perform as well on tests when they have been off cycle of the biological clock. So if you feel like your memory might be going, maybe look to your sleep cycle. Because sleep is critical to memory formation. So sleep is one of the greatest givers of health and longevity. What's the second one? Anyone want to know? You have it. Oh, gosh. You're cheating. Cheat. Yes. Very good. Here's a star pupil in the front row. Yes, of course, diet and what we're eating. And we don't have time to go into all the details tonight. And you know most of these things. But I want to bring up tonight some of them. One of the most important ones I will say right now, to be sure I don't forget, is B12. And how many of you have had your B12 level checked within the last year or two? Maybe about 1 out of 10 or 20 of you. So good. This is an extremely important vitamin, especially for vegetarians, although even non-vegetarians after age 65, about 1/3 of them are low in B12. If you're wondering about your memory or your balance or your attention or your sleep, or you get tingles in your feet or hands or just about anything that's not right with how your nervous system's working, you know, get your B12 level checked. In fact, get it checked anyway if you don't know what it is, at least once. And most vegetarians will need to take a supplement, and many non-vegetarians as well. So that's one of the most important things for diet. Also eating meals on time, because when we don't eat meals on time, our cortisol level kicks in to get our blood sugar up. And there's a balance in the body between cortisol, which we could call the stress hormone, which we know goes down with TM generally, and DHEA, which is a rejuvenating hormone. And they're kind of in balance in the body. If you get too much cortisol need, then your DHEA tends to get starved. Meditators in general have more DHEA. However, we don't want to stress our bodies. Too much cortisol basically breaks the body down. So eat your meals on time, go to sleep on time. Those are very important. So the third pillar of health is Brahmachari, which has been interpreted as balance of life or transcending. We know all the benefits of that. I don't have to lecture you on that. You could probably teach me a few things these days. And we also have, I would say, two hidden pillars or missing pillars today. Now that, I didn't put on the cheat sheet. So anyone want to guess what are two other things that are critical given we're living in 2011?
Exercise.
Beautiful, yes. And what was the other?
Social network.
Social network, yeah, good. On a computer before 8 at night. Just turn it off after that to save your melatonin. Well, actually, detoxification. It kind of comes in with diet because it should be part of the normal digestion and elimination that happens through eating the right foods. But today, with all the toxins everywhere, we have to be especially careful. And if there's one spice I would tell everybody to include every day, in fact, in every meal, what do you think it would be? God, you guys are so smart. Great. And practically, you're great. Yeah, absolutely. Use it. How many actually use it every day? Maybe 2 or 3 times. Fantastic. Great. Okay. So I would like to just go on to, I want to leave a little time for questions, so let me just hit a few high points of the other. I have to admit to you, although these are inspiring points, I have to say that one of the main reasons I wanted to speak to you today was actually because I've observed a kind of a disturbing trend in our community here of meditators, and it's not just common to meditators, also people who are very interested and dedicated to a natural, holistic lifestyle. But also, how many were on the first recertification course back in 2005? Great. So you may have sort of like some kind of internal like scar on your emotional system about modern medicine? I actually didn't attend, but I heard a lot about it. And, you know, actually, my transcendence from the Raj was actually part of Maharishi's kind of separating modern medicine from Maharshi Ayurveda at the time. However, now we are 6 years later, and even as Maharishi was still with us, he began developing a new form of medicine, or his Vedic medicine, his vision of what the ideal medical system was. And at one point, I don't know if it's officially called that now, but it was called Maharshi Integrative Medicine, or was suggested, and may yet be called that. Dr. Robert Schneider has been put in charge, actually, by Maharshi to bring out and to formalize and institutionalize this new form of medicine with medical schools, medical colleges, and health centers, like hospitals, in fact, which use, of course, Maharshi Ayurveda and everything we know from our tradition, but also modern medicine. Modern medicine side by side, integrated in the same place and in the same treatment program for all the patients, along with everything else that's proven to work through evidence-based science or through long cultural tradition, like traditional Chinese medicine, osteopathy, chiropractic, etc. So how many of those, how many were aware of that? Not maybe everybody. So it's a really important thing to know. And, you know, I think for whatever reason, we never know what Maharishi is trying or accomplishing on a subtle level or a cultural or societal level. But the end thing that he left us with, the vision on the model of healthcare, was a fully integrated one. Everything basically that can help people's health, keep people healthy, keep them living long. When you look at the long term for these treatments, generally, you know, controlling blood pressure, for example, or doing controlling blood sugar, these have been shown to reduce disease and long-term complications and extend life. So I just wanted to reflect with you that this was and is part of Maharshi's vision for ideal healthcare. And I'd like to bring up a few points of the high points of the main things that I see happening that I would like to encourage you to take a different path for yourself. You know, for example, high blood pressure. It's hard, I think, for many meditators to accept if their blood pressure is high that they really need to do anything about it, because we've heard through all this really well done long history of research that TM lowers blood pressure. But we also have to know that it only, you know, it reduces mortality, morbidity, or death, and heart attacks and all that by maybe 50%. But as we get older, it turns out, do you know what the greatest risk factor for breast cancer, for heart attack, for stroke is? Yeah, it's age. It's just how old we are, how many years we've been in this body. So as we get older, you know, there's factors of family and genetic predisposition and accumulated effects of toxins and many things that we may not have had control over. And blood pressure can start going up. And it's really important to control it, because the risk of stroke, for example, for women, for lifetime, is 1 in 5. But if they don't control their blood pressure and it's high, it's 1 in 2.5. I mean, that's really, really high. So even if, you know, TM cuts it in half, still it's 1 in 5. We don't want to have that kind of risk. We want to reduce it as much as possible. Can never be eliminated, but I wanted to say that there are many natural things to do to help lower blood pressure, other supplements and such. And it's fine to try all that. And, of course, exercise and probably sleep and diet and low salt and proper oils and all sorts of things can lower blood pressure. But the bottom line is, if you're doing that for 3 to 6 months and your blood pressure doesn't come down to the normal range, then you have to, I would encourage you to say, okay, you know, give yourself a time limit. And if it hasn't gone down, then look at other alternatives and control it. Continue to do those things. Maybe it'll take another 6 months or a year, or maybe it'll never go down. And you can be constantly thinking you're trying to get it down and it's going to be coming down, and it isn't. So I just want everybody to be really real. Be a little bit realist with yourself and your health, and do what's necessary to really take care of whatever it is that might come up for you with your health. Okay, so I'm going to just list off a couple other things, and then I'd like to have some time for questions. So we talked about B12, we talked about high blood pressure, which of course is a risk for stroke, which has been unfortunately happening even in this community the last few years. Colon cancer screening, colonoscopy. Now with the change in health insurance, most of health insurance have to pay for screening or preventive testing of the colonoscopy. That's very helpful because it can be $3,000 to get that test. But now insurance companies have to pay for it before your deductible. So check with your insurance agent. You might have to get a new policy or upgrade it to qualify. But unfortunately, I have to say that in this community, I've seen 5 colon or rectal cancers in the last 10 years in our community. So it's something that can happen. So take advantage of something that can be very life-saving and preventive. Vitamin D, you know about vitamin D. How many have had their vitamin D levels checked? Doctors are waking up to that. So quite a few of you. Chances are you're low. Most of the people in this country have a low vitamin D, especially in these northern regions. You know, aches and pains don't have to be just from aging. They can come from vitamin D deficiency. That was one of the first discoveries of low vitamin D at the Mayo Clinic. They discovered that their people who came in with aches and pains, most of them had vitamin D deficiency, and it went away when they were given vitamin D. So sunshine is one way, but check your level and get it into a normal range, because it decreases your risk of cancer to have normal vitamin D, helps your immune system, helps your nervous system. It just has a very wide-ranging effect in the body, as well as, of course, the bones. Bone density is a good thing to get checked. Hip fracture can happen in as many as 1 out of 6. There's a lifetime risk for women and men, maybe 1 out of 10, of having a hip fracture. And hip fractures can be life-altering. One-third of people who have a hip fracture end up having to be in assisted living or a nursing home. So it's a serious thing. And, of course, exercise and weight-bearing exercise can do dramatic things to improve bone density and bone strength, as well as balance. So these tips that I gave you on the sheet that you have, they may seem like they're things you've heard, many of them, over and over again, but I can't emphasize enough how much all pervasive those things are. Going to bed early, getting enough sleep, and exercising, and eating the good diet, meals on time. Those basic things really don't cost anything, and they're 90% of staying healthy. The last thing I wanted to say is Amrit Kalash, and that is, I'm not sure, how many people take Amrit these days? Quite a few. I've noticed in my practice that those people who've been taking it regularly for 20 years really do look younger. And seem to be very vital and doing very well. Maybe they're doing a lot of other things because they were so regular with that, but I think it does add up. And as I've learned more about the adrenal system and aging and stress, I've seen how really brilliant and genius this formula is. The Amrit Ambrosia, the little round tablet that's always been a tablet, tastes kind of licorice-y. If you have high blood pressure, that's licorice sensitive, you should stay away from it, or salt sensitive. But it's really, really good for the nervous system and your stress handling system. It has licorice and ashwagandha. Ashwagandha protects your memory system, the hippocampus in the brain, and many other things. And then the nectar in tablet form or paste also tremendous antioxidant protection. And interestingly, you know, taking antioxidants and pills, like taking a lot of vitamin C or E or all these pills, isolated nutrients, you know, they've been researched extensively for the last 15 years or so. And what they're finding is that they really don't pan out. They really don't, they don't deliver what was hoped to be delivered. Having high levels of them in your blood from a good diet are correlated with lower risks of diseases. But just popping these pills and getting the levels up artificially is not. But I would venture to say that the omelet, because it's a whole food, has a very different effect. And it will be like having something good in your diet. Like, after all, amla berry, the main ingredient, is a fruit. And the last thing is the anti-aging pearl I just discovered as I was reading more about this was that they said maybe the future, it seems like research is pointing that substances which increase the body's own antioxidant functioning seem to be more promising than just taking lots of antioxidants. And it turns out that an omelet nectar has been shown to increase the very two antioxidant enzymes that they're looking at, which is SOD, superoxide dismutase, and catalase. And omelet has been shown to improve those function of those enzymes quite significantly. So we're seeing how modern medicine is evolving gradually to the wisdom of Ayurveda after their magic bullet approach. And we have this huge, beautiful resource, all this knowledge Maharishi gave us, and much of it doesn't cost anything. And, you know, omelet, I think taking omelet and your B12 and your vitamin D and your calcium are probably a calcium support, the absorbable kind. Those are probably the key things, you know, some key supplements you can get by with the kind of the minimum there. Unless you have special needs. All right, so I would like to just reiterate that the quote at the top with Maharishi's quote on perfect health, which is balance is the key to perfect health. So your five pillars, balanced life, I encourage you to continue to strive to do that. And also to keep in mind his vision and model of health, that everything that works, everything that's proven to support health. These tests as listed here, like the cholesterol profiles, even the vitamin D, they would cost a lot. If you have a high deductible or something, you would have to pay hundreds of dollars at your local hospital or through your doctor perhaps. So you can go online and search for at-home test kit vitamin D or cholesterol or whatever, and there are sites which will send you these kits. You can go to a local hospital or laboratory, and they'll draw the blood and you send it to that lab online and they will give you results, and it costs a lot less. Okay.
What are the natural sources of B12 in the diet?
Natural sources of B12. Well, mostly dairy. It's all in for vegetarians. It's something that is reliably found only in animal products. So for vegetarians, it's dairy products. And if you're not eating dairy products, then you're and vegetarian, you're vegan, then you're really likely to get low in it. Spirulina has some in it, but it's not really clear whether that is biologically active or adequate. So this question, but the thing is, if you are test and you're low, and by the way, you should be at least 350 or 400 or higher. The test will normally tell you 250 or something is or below is deficient, but you should be, experts say, about 400 or more to be safe, because still at those low levels, lower levels, 15 or 20% of people will still be having deficiency, even though they're...
B12.
So what is that?
B12.
So dairy, B12 is in dairy, or a supplement. Yes?
So Nancy... I've read quite a lot about vitamin D in the past few years, and I just wanted to ask you to speak about the suggested levels, because my understanding has been that the recommended daily dose has been something like 400 IU, whereas the things that I read indicate like 8,000, 10,000. So there's quite a divergence.
So the question is, you know, how much should you supplement your vitamin D with? What dose? Well, first of all, get a level. So you know what you're dealing with. The 30 to 40 is considered, that's where the normal range usually is. That's the cutoff. If you're below that, then you're low. If you're above that, you're supposedly okay. But some experts feel that, you know, 50, 60, 70, or 80, that's your level in your blood, is a better level. The thing is, if you're lower, say you're 25, or I've seen it as low as 5, then doctors will usually treat it with aggressively. Like, they may give you a pill that has like 50,000 IUs in it and say, take this once a week for like 8 weeks. And then usually the level gets up into the normal range. We have to retest to be sure. So if you're just, you have to know where you are at. And if you're really low, then you probably do need like 7,000 or 8,000 IUs a day for maybe a few months. But once you get in the normal range, probably 1,000 a day will keep you where you need to be. But, you know, check it again after a year so you know you're not overdosing it. Yes?
Taking, there's a lot of different numbers out there in terms of cholesterol, blood pressure. Would you be willing to comment at all on what you think is a cholesterol level that's acceptable or what you think is a blood pressure level that's acceptable?
Okay, so the question is what blood pressure or cholesterol levels are acceptable. It actually is determined by what the rest of your health profile is. Like, for example, for cardiovascular disease, and whether to treat that or not. And there's a way to, like for cholesterol, there's, or LDL, the so-called bad cholesterol, there's a formula that your doctor can, you know, or you could find online, that takes into account your blood systolic blood pressure, your cholesterol level, your age, your whether you smoke or not. I think there might be one other thing. And they give you like a scale or numbers for each of those, and you can score yourself. And then if you're above a certain point, then they say you're high risk. Then you have to treat at a more aggressive level. But generally it's 130 for LDL, or if you have a diabetes or have high blood pressure or something, or have had a heart attack, then they like to keep it under 100. So it depends on the rest of the health history. But if your blood, say you're pretty healthy and you think you don't have risk factors, but your blood pressure is going between 140 and 160, that's an okay range to say, okay, I'm going to take 3 months and I'm going to get on an exercise regimen and I'm going to cut salt out of my diet and I'm going to do X, Y, and Z and see if it comes down. But if you're chronically running those that level, then, you know, the years go by, and the years go by, and sometimes the blood pressure creeps up more, and you're straining your heart. And when your heart strains, the muscle starts getting thicker. And when the muscle gets thicker, that's the first step in the muscle getting weaker. At some point, the heart starts, you know, enlarging, and at some point, it can't pump as efficiently, and that's when you start to get into heart failure. And that's something that is hard to reverse, or not really reversible, so.
Nancy?
Yeah.
Oh, Nancy? I wanted to ask you about up here. I wanted to ask you about water. For a very long time, it's been a standard that they say to drink 8 glasses of water a day. And recently, I've been reading that that's not really necessary, that you should drink more according to your level of thirst. So I've just been seeing this come up more and more, that mm-hmm. they're debunking this old theory that it was absolutely necessary to drink 6 to 8 glasses of water a day.
Well, I think everybody's different, but also people, there are a lot of people who never feel thirsty until they get a headache or they feel bad. And then they realize, okay, I'm dehydrated. And as people get older, the sensation of thirst can be less intense or less noticeable. So I think it's still a good habit. I mean, if you're drinking all day and just peeing completely clear, non-yellow urine, you know, every hour and a half, then you're probably drinking more than your body needs. But, you know, look, if it's yellow urine or you're not drinking at least, you know, you're not getting hydrated. I think it's a good idea. You know, you flush toxins out when you urinate, and we're exposed to stuff all the time and everything. So you want to keep your kidneys clear. Oh, by the way, speaking of kidneys and toxins, heavy metals, it's been an issue, you know, with herbs directly from India. I advise you, you know, we were actually advised years ago not to buy or take herbs directly from India. And even Mapi India, I will say, they, you know, this, their herbs are not subjected to American laboratory independent testing. And their herbs may, some of them may contain heavy metals. So really pay the premium and protect your health and use the Mapi products, which have always, since 1985 when they started, or four, have always been tested in independent labs, every batch that comes from India. And they do send things back. And it's something you can count on, the quality control. Yes. You can come up and drag me off. Okay, last question. Sorry. I'll stay after so that anyone who wants to ask questions can. Thank you very much.